The infinite monkey theorem states that a monkey hitting keys at random on a typewriter keyboard for an infinite amount of time will almost surely type a given text, such as the complete works of William Shakespeare. In this context, almost surely is a mathematical term with a precise meaning, and the monkey is not an actual monkey, but a metaphor for an abstract device that produces an endless random sequence of letters and symbols. One of the earliest instances of the use of the monkey metaphor is that of French mathematician Émile Borel in 1913, but the first instance may be even earlier. The relevance of the theorem is questionable. The probability of a universe full of monkeys typing a complete work such as Shakespeare's Hamlet is so tiny that the chance of it occurring during a period of time hundreds of thousands of orders of magnitude longer than the age of the universe is extremely low. It should also be noted that real monkeys do not produce uniformly random output, which means that an actual monkey hitting keys for an infinite amount of time has no statistical certainty of ever producing any given text. Variants of the theorem include multiple, and even infinitely many typists, and the target text varies between an entire library and a single sentence. The history of these statements can be traced back to Aristotle's On Generation and Corruption and Cicero's De Natura Deorum, through Blaise Pascal and Jonathan Swift, and finally to modern statements with their iconic simians and typewriters. In the early 20th century, Émile Borel and Arthur Eddington used the theorem to illustrate the timescales implicit in the foundations of statistical mechanics. Solution: direct proof. There is a straightforward proof of this theorem. As an introduction, recall that if two events are statistically independent, then the probability of both happening equals the product of the probabilities of each one happening independently. For example, if the chance of rain in Moscow on a particular day in the future is 0.4 and the chance of an earthquake in San Francisco on any particular day is 0.00003, then the chance of both happening on the same day is 0.4 times 0.00003 equals 0.00012, assuming that they are indeed independent. Suppose the typewriter has 50 keys, and the word to be typed is banana. If the keys are pressed randomly and independently, it means that each key has an equal chance of being pressed. Then, the chance that the first letter typed is B is 1/50th, and the chance that the second letter typed is A is also 1/50th, and so on. Therefore, the chance of the first six letters speaking banana is times equals 6 equals 1/15,625,000,000th, less than 1 in 15 billion, but not 0. Hence a possible outcome. From the above, the chance of not typing banana in a given block of six letters is 1 minus 6. Because each block is typed independently, the chance xn of not typing banana in any of the first n blocks of six letters is as n grows, xn gets smaller. For an n of a million, xn is roughly 0.9999, but for an n of 10 billion, xn is roughly 0.53, and for an n of 100 billion, it is roughly 0.0017. As n approaches infinity, the probability xn approaches zero, that is, by making n large enough, xn can be made as small as is desired, and the chance of typing banana approaches 100%. The same argument shows why at least one of infinitely many monkeys will produce a text as quickly as it would be produced by a perfectly accurate human typist copying it from the original. In this case, xn equals 6n, where xn represents the probability that none of the first n monkeys types banana correctly on their first try. When we consider 100 billion monkeys, the probability falls to 0.17%, and as the number of monkeys n increases, the value of xn, the probability of the monkeys failing to reproduce the given text, approaches zero arbitrarily closely. The limit for n going to infinity is zero. So the probability of the word banana appearing at some point after an infinite number of keystrokes is equal to 1. Infinite strings. This can be stated more generally and compactly in terms of strings, which are sequences of characters chosen from some finite alphabet. Given an infinite string where each character is chosen uniformly at random, any given finite string almost surely occurs as a substring at some position. Given an infinite sequence of infinite strings, where each character of each string is chosen uniformly at random, any given finite string almost surely occurs as a prefix of one of these strings. Both follow easily from the second Borel-Cantor lemma. For the second theorem, let ek be the event that the kth string begins with the given text. Because this has some fixed non-zero probability p of occurring, the ek are independent, and the below sum diverges. The probability that infinitely many of the ek occur is 1. The first theorem is shown similarly. One can divide the random string into non-overlapping blocks matching the size of the desired text, and make ek the event where the kth block equals the desired string. Probabilities, however, for physically meaningful numbers of monkeys typing for physically meaningful lengths of time, the results are reversed. If there were as many monkeys as there are atoms in the observable universe typing extremely fast for trillions of times the life of the universe, the probability of the monkeys replicating even a single page of Shakespeare is unfathomably minute. Ignoring punctuation, spacing, and capitalization, a monkey typing letters uniformly at random has a chance of 1 in 26 of correctly typing the first letter of Hamlet. It has a chance of 1 in 676 of typing the first two letters. Because the probability shrinks exponentially, at 20 letters it already has only a chance of 1 in 2620 equals 19928148895209409152341977376. In the case of the entire text of Hamlet, the probabilities are so vanishingly small as to be inconceivable. The text of Hamlet contains approximately 130,000 letters. Thus there is a probability of 1 in 3.4 times 10,183, 946 to get the text right at the first trial. The average number of letters that needs to be typed until the text appears is also 3.4 times 10,183, 946, or including punctuation, 4.4 times 10,360, 783. Even if every proton in the observable universe were a monkey with a typewriter, typing from the Big Bang until the end of the universe, they would still need a ridiculously longer time, more than 360,000 orders of magnitude longer, to have even a 1 Indiana 10500 chance of success. To put it another way, for a 1 in a trillion chance of success, there would need to be 10,360, 641 universes made of atomic monkeys. As Kittel and Cromer put it, the probability of Hamlet is therefore zero in any operational sense of an event, and the statement that the monkeys must eventually succeed gives a misleading conclusion about very, very large numbers. This is from their textbook on thermodynamics, the field whose statistical foundations motivated the first known expositions of typing monkeys. In fact, there is less than a 1 in a trillion chance of success that such a universe made of monkeys could type any particular document a mere 79 characters long. Almost surely, the probability that an infinite randomly generated string of text will contain a particular finite substring is 1. However, this does not mean the substring's absence is impossible, despite the absence having a prior probability of 0. For example, the immortal monkey could randomly type G as its first letter, G as its second, and G as every single letter thereafter, producing an infinite string of G's. At no point must the monkey be compelled to type anything else, however long a randomly generated finite string is. There is a small but non-zero chance that it will turn out to consist of the same character repeated throughout. This chance approaches zero as the string's length approaches infinity. There is nothing special about such a monotonous sequence except that it is easy to describe. The same fact applies to any nameable specific sequence, such as RGRGRG, repeated forever, or ABAABBRBBB, or 3, 6, 9, 12. If the hypothetical monkey has a typewriter with 90 equally likely keys that include numerals and punctuation, then the first typed keys might be 3.14, with a probability of 4, which is 1/65,610,000. Equally probable as any other string of four characters allowed by the typewriter, such as GGGG, Math, or Q%AT. The probability that 100 randomly typed keys will consist of the first 99 digits of pi, or any other particular sequence of that length, is much lower, 100. If the monkey's allotted length of text is infinite, the chance of typing only the digits of pi is zero, which is just as possible as typing nothing but g's. The same applies to the event of typing a particular version of Hamlet followed by endless copies of itself, or Hamlet immediately followed by all the digits of pi. These specific strings are equally infinite in length. They are not prohibited by the terms of the thought problem, and they each have a prior probability of zero. In fact, any particular infinite sequence the immortal monkey types will have had a prior probability of zero, even though the monkey must type something. This is an extension of the principle that a finite string of random text has a lower and lower probability of being a particular string the longer it is. This probability approaches zero as the string approaches infinity. Thus, the probability of the monkey typing an endlessly long string, such as all of the digits of pi in order, on a 90-key keyboard is infinity, which is essentially zero. At the same time, the probability that the sequence contains a particular subsequence increases as the total string increases. This probability approaches 1 as the total string approaches infinity, and thus the original theorem is correct. Correspondence between strings and numbers in a simplification of the thought experiment. The monkey could have a typewriter with just two keys, 1 and 0. The infinitely long string thusly produced would correspond to the binary digits of a particular real number between 0 and 1. A countably infinite set of possible strings end in infinite repetitions, which means the corresponding real number is rational. Examples include the strings corresponding to 1/3, 5/6 and 5/8. Only a subset of such real number strings contains the entirety of Hamlet. Meanwhile, there is an uncountably infinite set of strings which do not end in such repetition. These correspond to the irrational numbers. These can be sorted into two uncountably infinite subsets, those which contain Hamlet and those which do not. However, the largest subset of all the real numbers are those which not only contain Hamlet, but which contain every other possible string of any length, and with equal distribution of such strings. These irrational numbers are called normal, because almost all numbers are normal. Almost all possible strings contain all possible finite substrings. Hence, the probability of the monkey typing a normal number is 1. The same principles apply regardless of the number of keys from which the monkey can choose. A 90-key keyboard can be seen as a generator of numbers, written in base 90. History. Statistical mechanics in one of the forms in which probabilists now know this theorem, with its dactylographic, i.e., typewriting, monkeys, appeared in Emil Borel's 1913 article, Mécanique statistique et réversibilité, and in his book, Le Hasard, in 1914. His monkeys are not actual monkeys. Rather, they are a metaphor for an imaginary way to produce a large, random sequence of letters. Borel said that if a million monkeys typed 10 hours a day, it was extremely unlikely that their output would exactly equal all the books of the richest libraries of the world, and yet, in comparison, it was even more unlikely that the laws of statistical mechanics would ever be violated, even briefly. The physicist Arthur Eddington drew on Borel's image further in The Nature of the Physical World, writing, "If I let my fingers wander idly over the keys of a typewriter, it might happen that my screed made an intelligible sentence. If an army of monkeys were strumming on typewriters, they might write all the books in the British Museum. The chance of their doing so is decidedly more favorable than the chance of the molecules returning to one half of the vessel." These images invite the reader to consider the incredible improbability of a large but finite number of monkeys working for a large but finite amount of time producing a significant work, and compare this with the even greater improbability of certain physical events. Any physical process that is even less likely than such monkeys' success is effectively impossible, and it may safely be said that such a process will never happen. It is clear from the context that Eddington is not suggesting that the probability of this happening is worthy of serious consideration. On the contrary, it was a rhetorical illustration of the fact that below certain levels of probability, the term improbable is functionally equivalent to impossible. Origins of the Total Library. In a 1939 essay entitled The Total Library, Argentine writer Jorge Luis Borges traced the infinite monkey concept back to Aristotle's Metaphysics, explaining the views of Leucippus, who held that the world arose through the random combination of atoms. Aristotle notes that the atoms themselves are homogeneous and their possible arrangements only differ in shape, position and ordering. In On Generation and Corruption, the Greek philosopher compares this to the way that a tragedy and a comedy consist of the same atoms, i.e., alphabetic characters. 3 centuries later, Cicero's De Natura Deorum argued against the atomist worldview. He who believes this may as well believe that if a great quantity of the 21 letters, composed either of gold or any other matter, were thrown upon the ground, they would fall into such order as legibly to form the Annals of Ennius. I doubt whether fortune could make a single verse of them. By 1939, the idiom was that a half dozen monkeys provided with typewriters would, in a few eternities, produce all the books in the British Museum. Borges then imagines the contents of the total library which this enterprise would produce if carried to its fullest extreme. Everything would be in its blind volumes. Everything. The detailed history of the future, Aeschylus of the Egyptians. The exact number of times that the waters of the Ganges have reflected the flight of a falcon, the secret and true nature of Rome. The Encyclopedia Novalis would have constructed My Dreams and Half Dreams at Dawn on August 14, 1934, the proof of Pierre Fermat's theorem, the unwritten chapters of Edwin Drood, those same chapters translated into the language spoken by the Garamantis, the paradoxes Berkeley invented concerning time but didn't publish, Urizen's Books of Iron, the premature epiphanies of Stephen Dedalus, which would be meaningless before a cycle of 1,000 years, the Gnostic Gospel of Basilides, the song the sirens sang, the complete catalogue of the library, the proof of the inaccuracy of that catalogue, everything. But for every sensible line or accurate fact there would be millions of meaningless cacophonies, verbal farragos, and babblings, everything. But all the generations of mankind could pass before the dizzying shelves, shelves that obliterate the day and on which chaos lies, ever reward them with a tolerable page. Borges' total library concept was the main theme of his widely read 1941 short story, The Library of Babel, which describes an unimaginably vast library consisting of interlocking hexagonal chambers, together containing every possible volume that could be composed from the letters of the alphabet and some punctuation characters, real monkeys. In 2003, lecturers and students from the University of Plymouth Media Lab Arts course used a £2,000 grant from the Arts Council to study the literary output of real monkeys. They left a computer keyboard in the enclosure of 6 Sellaby's crested macaques in Paignton Zoo in Devon in England for a month, with a radio link to broadcast the results on our website. Not only did the monkeys produce nothing but 5 total pages largely consisting of the letter S, the lead male began by bashing the keyboard with a stone, and the monkeys continued by urinating and defecating on it. Mike Phillips, director of the university's Institute of Digital Arts and Technology, said that the artist-funded project was primarily performance art, and they had learned an awful lot from it. He concluded that monkeys are not random generators. They're more complex than that. They were quite interested in the screen, and they saw that when they typed a letter, something happened.